And Sarah Heusch from Smart, Belgium, and Valeria Pulignano from the University of Leuven. Are you
as part of the project is Smart growing up. I remember the first meeting here was sort of in a garage. We had to go to all kinds of little areas, there were old couches here, and sort of second-hand computers, everything dedicated to a cause. You know, it felt very it felt very alive. It still feels alive, but it looks very different now. So, so I'm happy to be here now in this place. We organized the commentary in sort of sequence because I will stay relatively close to what we found in the data. Valeria will take a broader perspective, sort of linking it to industrial relations perspective, and Sarah will sort of partly take it also into the future and sort of what it actually means for organizations in this field. And then we hope to engage your comments as well. So. Well, following up on Anna's great presentation, so the 29 cases was a lot of rich material, a lot of variety, so compliments for bringing it together in this very clear clear way. Now, for me, I'm from a business school, right, so which is maybe a strange thing to say. I thought, oh, I'll talk about social dialogue. and then still, I'm engaged in this project, so I'm thinking, what am I doing there on that stage? And actually, I think the key thing for me is that if we talk about social dialogue in this context, it's broader. It's about new ways of support for autonomous workers. So it's social dialogue is part of that, but sort of the servicing model, Anna already said, does it relate to the dialogue? Yes, I think so. So I'll come to that briefly. So let me, in terms of my comments, go to what we saw and what I saw sort of from studying these organizations, what made most impressions. So in terms of social dialogue, looking at our case organizations, one thing that's quite interesting is that you see the difficulty of dealing with the gray zone exemplified in the roles that the different organizations take. For example, in the Netherlands, we have the Social Economic Council, which is a sort of a representative body of social dialogue with employer representation, union representation, and sort of crowd members, which is academics. And people are on sort of other sort of neutral merit in a way. But you see that when issues around self-employment are being discussed, there are two parties in the room that say they represent the self-employed. On the one hand, it's based on those that say one of our case studies also, which actually is on one of the seats of the medium and small-sized enterprises in the social economic council. And it takes the entrepreneur perspective. So we self-employed people are entrepreneurs, and we have to secure the freedom to innovate and do their thing, and sort of not try to limit their possibilities. On the other side, we have the unions, and the unions are represented by union federations in the Social Economic Council, but they represent a number of unions operating for self-employed. Self-employed in the arts, self-employed in the construction sector, and their perspective is different. They say, we talk about individual workers who need protection. And you see that debate in these bodies plays out along these lines with different actors of human representation. Another thing is extent of engagement with social dialogue of all the actors involved. If you look at our case studies, we see some actors that are actually sort of at the edges of what is allowed. They experiment with new solutions because not all the existing structures sort of really make it possible to do everything that they think is necessary for these autonomous workers to operate. So we have some cases that we where actually people don't engage in social dialogue explicitly. They try to work for their members and try to come up with solutions, and in some ways they're experimenting. So they're experimenting in social space, trying to come up with ways of doing things differently. And so it reminded me, when I was studying the temporary work agency industry, of the early years of the agency industry, where they also sort of were in this liminal space between sort of what was allowed and what was not allowed, but they were solving some problems, so they were allowed to operate, but they were learning a lot. So you see many organizations doing kind of experimentation that actually triggers thinking about sort of what should be allowed. Now, other actors explicitly seek debate and are in this lobbying role. They seek to influence regulation and engage in social dialogue. But I think the question for social dialogue that comes out is, who are these novel actors, and sort of what is a social partner? Because the traditional social partners, sort of that might be enough. And what are the ways in which you can stimulate engagement and learn from experience of all these different actors that are popping up? And again, I refer to the Dutch situation, where, for example, in the arts, there is a collaboration that is sort of organizational field-wide, it's industry-wide, where in organizations like many of the employers, the unions, independent actors are grouped together, and they actually discuss sort of the future of the sector, and they have official roles sort of coming up with ideas and suggestions for policy. Because at that level of getting together as an industry, they are broader than just traditional social life. Okay, so that's about social dialogue. The second thing is about that broader perspective, support for autonomous workers. It relates to what Anna said, functional equivalence to social protection, but also functional equivalence to support, I think. Why is that relevant? Traditionally, I think there was a division of labor. So we had the social dialogue, and there were agreements reached in the social dialogue. And subsequently, we had this convenient vehicle for implementing these things, which were employers with their organizations, because these could be held accountable, and these could also support and make sure that these things were introduced and actually made it happen. Now, if we are in a situation where we work with a lot of self-employed, you need a new place to provide that support. So that is, I think, where the servicing model comes in, and sort of as an extension, maybe even of social dialogue. And on the other hand, also what happens is we see that the organizations that are mostly lobbying, they actually are looking for ways to enter these servicing activities, because they say that brings us closer to what is actually happening on the ground, and we can better understand what self-employed people need. So we see a lot of these services. Anna already told us about the different types of services offered. The question there is about access to these services. So do all these services provide the same kind of facilities to self-employed workers? And I think there is a difference, because different organizations can offer the same kind of services, but they do it with different objectives. So some of them offer services open to all autonomous workers. Some of them are only open to members, but then if you're a member, you can can get it whenever you want. And then there are also organizations that that actually operate as market actors, and they decide whether an autonomous worker will be let in and can make use of their services. So the openness of the services and the discretion sort of the third party actors. And those are market actors that bring in sort of their own set of thoughts in the relationship. So with these reflections, sort of, I think we talk about social dialogue, we talk about support and servicing, but it makes the picture rich and a little bit more complex, but it also makes it more concrete sort of about what you can do.
Well, first of all, thank you very much again for inviting me to be here to talk to you. I think I'm in the kind of role of the outsider, if I may use a labor market terminology here. So I've not been working on the project, but I actually I was pleased to be invited and also to be kind of recruited yesterday evening at 8 o'clock to say, well, are you prepared to say something tomorrow morning? So, I mean, I actually took some notes and I will hopefully draw some hopefully considerations for reflection from my background as an industrial relations sociologist. So, I've been thinking across the issue of representation, actually, particularly reading this morning very fast the report which was sent to me by Anna, and also listening now about the report, which is very interesting. And when we talk about representation, particularly again from an industrial relations perspective, we talk about, as has been also mentioned, I think this morning, I think it was also Renato mentioned that, but it came also in the discussions, representation of interests. Now, this basically brings to another core issue, which is what do you need to be representative? And to be representative, you need to share what are the main features of a broader population. Now, we all know that if this broader population is the population of, let's call it workers, I don't now distinguish between self-employed or not, then we know also that trade unions and employers organizations, they have a big problem with that. Yeah? So trade unions and employers organizations are never representative only in those terms. And they have never been, probably. But, and this is where I want to get here now, from a more kind of analytical perspective, I think there are three dimensions, which, by the way, have been recalled a long time ago, at the end of the 90s, by Richard Diamond, when he wrote about the future of employee representation in Europe. At that time, he could never imagine what would have happened within the next 20 years. But anyway, he was talking about three dimensions, which I was reflecting upon this morning when I was listening about the interesting discussion. Now, these are the three dimensions which are important to be representative, or let's say are the central issue of representation. One is autonomy, the other is legitimacy, and the third one is efficacy. Now, autonomy, what does it mean? It means that you need to be independent, yeah? So independence in terms of having independence of a representative mechanism from the employer. And that's the reason why, in fact, very important the rank and file employee representation structures, if I look from a union perspective in workplaces, that's where they were actually also used for. So it is about the relationship, actually, of the representative to the, let's say, constituency which is represented. And I think this autonomy concept, and I will come back to that, is, according to me, probably one of the three dimensions which at the very moment is really challenged by this form of self-representation. Yeah? So and in that respect, I do think that not only labor market intermediates as smart, but also trade unions should really think about it, because autonomy is really something that is challenged, according to me. Now, the second one is legitimacy. Legitimacy is what? Is actually the precondition of the representativity of the representatives. Which is, in fact, also based on this idea also of autonomy, if you like. and which is sustained through a record of what? Of delivering goods, good goods, which is, you know, what the people who are represented are asking for. And therefore, basically what happens is that if you don't deliver the goods that the people you're representing, they ask for, you lose this legitimacy. Yeah? So basically, there is a failure when you have a failure to deliver something, you actually are not legitimate anymore. Now the question is that sometimes, and here I go. Does it work? Yes, it works. Now, the question is that now legitimacy has been something very challenging for trade unions. Now, Anna pointed out at the very beginning, you know, the challenge of unions, declining in union membership and so forth, and also the presentation of Francois this morning also addressed this issue as well. Now, the question is that issue of membership is also related to this issue of legitimacy, and probably I would say from my perspective, legitimacy is even more important, because when unions are facing, and we go back to the conditions here, when unions are facing hard times because they don't have the capacity, they don't have the structures to do certain things, they are not having the conditions which are favorable to them to do certain things, they actually are in fact failing to deliver what they represented they want from them. And that's, I think, is the kind of, many people have been writing on that, the crisis of legitimacy of the trade unions, like you say, not only from the 2000s, but also starting from the mid-90s, basically, yeah? So, and the third one is efficacy. Yeah, efficacy is, in economic terms, is a measure of the success of, you know, union officials or employee representatives to deliver certain goods on time when people ask it. Now, going back to these three dimensions, as I said before, I do think that autonomy is, in fact, the dimension which is much more challenged nowadays. And the question, I think, for us would be also to ask why this is challenged. Is it because of the self-employed status, whatever they have, without or not employees? Yes, but what if there is behind that? And I think that probably, and I was also having a chat earlier on with Renata, I think that, you know, this project is fantastic. If your mind wants to think about going on, one question would be also to say, well, to kind of connect the different nexus, I would say, looking at the side of new business models, and looking at the way how these business models are also kind of undermining or, in a way, changing the kind of structures where we are in. So changing in management policies and strategies is important, and I think needs to be looked at if we want to understand how these dimensions are threatened. Now you might tell to me, yeah, but this tells us also about unions. No, I don't think so. I think it's very important also for labor market intermediates. Because again, when I look at our talk, when I look at autonomy, why I said that according to me is challenged, because basically the self-employed, which de facto are independent, they already have the independency which previously a subordinated workers didn't have. Yeah? So they are independent, but they are dependent under different laws. And this came very much into the discussion this morning in all the presentation. They depend economically on income, they depend also on social protection. They need social protection in terms of they don't have it. They need to, you know, kind of have and being helped in accessing this kind of social protection. So this independency that they have doesn't allow them, in other words, to access what paradoxically previously was possible by the normal subordinated workers. And so what do we need here? Well, you teach me, we need social rights to give to those people. We need also, I think, important, decent working conditions. I don't talk about bargaining here, but I talk about decent and fair working conditions. And we need to actually also address the issue that these decent working conditions need to be guaranteed on a collective basis. Otherwise, we are not, I think, on the probably, according to me, we are in a situation where we are also then fragmenting the labour market more than what the labour market now is fragmented. And there, if I go back to the presentation of Anna and also in line with your idea, I also do believe, and I give the floor to Sarah on that, the coalition building is in fact a very nice trajectory in that respect. For two reasons, for me, or to me, it looks like, you know, of course these workers need rights, but also they need to have, they need to be guaranteed the framework where they can also improve their own working conditions as a reflection of those social rights. And then when I talk about working conditions, I'm referring to wages, but also I'm referring to many other stuff. Work-life balance, as came across the survey, is a very important issue. And I do think that, you know, these are, in fact, elements which, you know, need to be taken into consideration. And I need to start the floor to go. Hi.
Hello everybody, so I'm here as SMART and to speak to a organization that is working in the field and how we see all these issues and to react to what has been presented by Anna and Cass and Harry as well. So first of all, before speaking about the coalition building, which is really a crucial aspect for us, I really wanted to stress how important it is for us that the question of autonomy, of self-employed, and also the gray zone.